I'm really happy. Oh, no. Sounds good. Anyway, I'm really happy to be here. And I'm especially happy because Sheila is going to do this with me. I'm usually having to do this by myself out there. And it's nice, but it's kind of lonely up there. You know how it is. So this is good. And Sheila's a great actress. I met her through a friend when we went to see her in our town. Everyone knows that play. And she was like, you were the narrator, which is unusual because usually it's a man that narrates. But she pulled it off with flying colors. And at that time, when I met her, it was like before, when I was just starting to write the book, and I had like about 10 pages, and I read it. It was up in the wine, not the wine country, the gold country, right? Sonora was around that area. And that's where she used to live at the time. And so I read it up there, and then she was saying, one day, maybe we can do something together, because I used to act too. Believe it or not. And so this is kind of one of those dream come true. And what we're going to do is the section where it would be appropriate for her to be in it, since, you know, the book, she couldn't play every part. Maybe you could, but visually we don't want to strain you. So she's going to play Nurse Horn, maybe one day Miss Humphrey in the bar scene. But tonight we thought we'd do the Nurse Horn scenes, and I'm going to do a scene that Nurse Horn's not in by myself, the Sean scene, so you'll get an idea of Stevie's boyfriend before she meets Nurse Horn. So anyway, I don't know how many, some of you have probably read the book, right? How many of you done your homework here at the library? Okay, many of you. You know, I did a reading. Sometimes people read like about, that's about a good normal. And you're normal, San Francisco. But it was Capitola. I did a reading in Capitola. We had a really good size audience about like this, you know, Santa Cruz. So, but I said, how many have read the book? I mean, one person, one in Santa Cruz. But they were there. They'd heard of me. They came out, but they hadn't read it. They carried it around looking cool, bro, you know, but they hadn't read it, no. But so this one person got to kind of dictate it more, what I read that night. Well, what do you think? It would always be that, you know, what if nobody else could say anything. But this time, we already know what we're going to read. Because a lot of places I go and I say, what do you want to hear? And you'd be surprised. Maybe you wouldn't be. Most places, I went all over the country, most of the country, the South, the Midwest, the East. I went to about 16 cities. And the most popular section was the diary section, those of you who've read the book. You know, people just wanted me to get nasty wherever I went. It was like the diary, you know, grown people. So anyway, but this tonight, we already know what we're going to do, class. So we don't have a chance for input, but I think you'll enjoy it. The book is set in starts in 1965. It goes from 1965 to 1970. It starts when the main character, Jean Stevie Stevenson, is 11 and a half. And a lot of it is her struggle to grow up in spite of her mother's help. And, you know, some of it's funny and some of it's kind of, they said some people describe it as harrowing. I don't know if I'd go that far, okay? Harrowing to me is not, yeah, not based on your life. Huh? No, he said that's not harrowing. I wouldn't go that far. But, you know, poignant. It is poignant at times. But anyway, so a lot of it's about friendship, coming to terms, growing up, you know, sexuality, little peer stuff, etc. And we're going to move along from... Oh, let me say this, too, about the book. It's been nominated by the American Library Association, especially since we're in the library here, as Best Book of 94 Fiction Young Adult. So maybe it will win. But even if it doesn't win, it's the important thing is it was nominated, and I am thankful and honored. Also, it's number two in the country in black bookstores or black readers in Essence and Blackboard now. Now you wouldn't know by looking at this audience, you know, but I have a very diverse following, so anyway. But it's very universal. I'm really glad because the book is able to cut across all lines in different parts of the country, different people come out, but it has really, you know, been able to appeal to people across all, you know, race, gender, et cetera. So that's, I'm really pleased about. Let's see, I'll start. I'm just getting people, you know, I'm talking a little so that people can come in and sit down so that we don't have them doing it when I'm doing it. So you can come up here. Let's see, I don't know if you two can sit together unless you'll be behind him. You might want to sit like, yes. We aim to please here, okay. Okay, this is 1969, this is set in Chicago. Some of you will remember 1969. In fact, it looks like all of you in here could remember. The few exceptions should be able to remember. Well, 69, I mean, it wasn't that long. And actually, Sheila, this first scene, you're in it. I know you remember 1969. This first scene, Sheila's in it. We're going to do two scenes where two of them we're both in the middle scene, you're not in it, so I'll come back here so they won't have the illusion of you being in it by me sitting over there. So I'll come over here and join you, and then I'll leave to do the scene that's in between.
Okay. And this is on? Yeah.
I hope it travels. So this is the first time we've done this, so don't expect. Now, it's going to be good. I mean, but don't expect me to, you know, this little part, things like that.
If you can't hear me, let me. Can you hear me? Yeah?
I should bring my water.
Over.
I'll get my water. Okay. Feel bad. Okay. Okay, this is like 1969. Remember those years? Okay, good. Let's go there. I was sitting in Stevie's 16, I should say that. Or she just made 16, yeah. Junior in high school. I was sitting in the office of my guidance counselor, Mrs. Stewart. I'd seen her before, but we'd never met. She was an attractive woman in her 30s with a caramel complexion. She wore her hair in a large afro and was a sharp dresser. I looked at the big clock on the wall. It was 10 after 2. Mrs. Stewart was 10 minutes late. My homeroom teacher had told me that I needed to meet with her to plan my future since I had been accepted into the Junior Honor Society. I was surprised to hear a white woman's voice.
I'm tired of just being seen for my color.
Nurse Horn sighed and ran her fingers through her short brown hair. I watched as the school nurse followed Mrs. Stewart into the office. I'd been down to Nurse Horn's office with cramps a few times, so we nodded at each other.
I want to be seen as an individual too.
Nurse Horn continued.
I marched with Dr. King. I was arrested during Freedom Summer in Mississippi. Pamela, I'm not just any white person.
Diane, do you think you deserve a medal? Mrs. Stewart asked, folding her arms against her rust-colored suit.
No, I don't think that I deserve a medal. But I am tired of black people who haven't paid half as many dues making judgments about me. I want to be judged by the content of my character, like Dr. King said.
If you're black, you don't have to march to pay dues, Diane. You pay dues just by breathing. Mrs. Stewart glanced at me. Jean, sorry to have kept you waiting. I'll be with you as soon as I can. That's okay. I'm not in any rush.
Pamela, how can things ever change if we don't get to know each other as people? What do we march for anyway?
I marched with Dr. King too, Diane, and I didn't march just so that black folks and white folks could be bosom buddies. I marched for equal opportunity and justice.
Well, as long as the black teachers sit at one end of the teacher's lunchroom and the white teachers sit at the other end, what's the difference between today and the 50s? We may as well go back to separate but equal.
Look, it was separate, but it was never equal. Was it, Jean? I shook my head, remembering the picture of the two water fountains in my Afro-American history book. White people have made it quite clear that they don't want to live next door to us, haven't they, Jean? I nodded.
Some white people. I don't appreciate being lumped together with all white people, Pamela.
Mrs. Stewart continued. All it takes is for one black family to move into a neighborhood, and the for sale signs go up so fast it makes your head spin. And white folks have made it crystal clear that they don't want their children to go to school with us, haven't they, Jean? That's true, I agree. Nurse Horn looked at me with her soft gray eyes. I didn't have anything against her, but the truth was the truth. I mean, what else could I say?
Some white people, Pamela.
Like Jesse Jackson says, it's not the bus, it's us. So no wonder we need to separate to figure out who we are as black people. How much rejection can you expect people to take? Right, Jean? Right, I answered. I mean, Mrs. Stewart had a point.
So does that mean if I see you sitting with black teachers at a table and I join you, You will pretend that I'm not there again?
When I taught at a white school over on the northwest side, I had to sit alone. I had to eat alone. No one gave me the time of day. Sometimes I felt like I was invisible.
Is that how you want me to feel?
Look, Diane, if you come into the teacher's room and I'm alone, you can join me. Otherwise, wait for an invitation, okay?
I'm supposed to forget your black on one hand, and then on the other hand, I'm never supposed to forget your black. Is that it?
That's what we have to do. Isn't that so, Jean? For an odd moment, Nurse Horn and I exchanged glances. Okay, that's one scene. All of this is going to take place in the fall of 69, and this is a little after that. And this is a scene with Stevie and Sean, her soon-to-become boyfriend. Never mind. On with the show. Okay. I grabbed a handful of junk out of the locker next to mine. It had been vacant since the beginning of the school year. A tall stranger wearing a navy pea coat stood in front of the locker holding a briefcase and a combination lock. I'm sorry, I didn't know it had been assigned anybody. I guess I'll never get the good housekeeping seal. That's okay, he smiled. He was cute. He looked like Jermaine of the Jackson 5. Fine as he wanted to be, with his bronze skin and big fro. Hey, haven't I seen you before? I smiled. Aren't you supposed to ask me what my sign is instead? No jive, I'm being for real. It's your eyes. They're so pretty. I know I've seen you before. Well, it is possible. This is my third year here. I am a junior. I'm new, I just transferred in, I'm a senior. My name's Sean. You're a senior, I repeated respectfully. He nodded. Where did you transfer from? Leo High School. That's a Catholic boys' school. Yeah, I noticed, Sean frowned. Why'd you transfer your senior year? That must really be hard. Sean shrugged. Well, so how come you're starting over a month into the semester, I asked. I went back to Leo, and I just realized it wasn't my bag. I didn't want to be around nothing but dudes. And besides, I was tired of the whole Catholic trip. Hey, I'm ready to have some fun this year, Sean smiled. Hey, won't you have to go to confession? Hell no, because I'm not Catholic. Well, what were you doing in a Catholic school then? Hey, lots of black folks who aren't Catholics send their kids to Catholic schools. That's true. My old friends Melody and Linda go to Mercy High School, and neither of them are Catholic. They go to Faith AME just like I do. I know who you are now. You denied me. Denied you? Denied you what? First, I thought Sean was jive. Now I wondered if he was crazy. Although he didn't look off, you never could be sure. I was Jesus Christ. Sean was definitely off, I thought. I started to back away from him. Come back, Peter. You were my disciple. Oh, I smiled, a light finally going on in my head. The Easter play. I remember you too, Sean. It's just that the last time that I saw you, you were carrying a cardboard cross and you had ketchup dripping down your face. That's right. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do, Sean said. Before the cock crows three times, I will have denied him, I recited. You didn't stumble once, even back then. My mother said that me and you were the only ones up there who enunciated, I laughed. I remember now, all the girls wanted to be Jesus' mother or Mary Magdalene, the prostitute, but you volunteered to play Peter. That took guts. Hey, I was looking for a challenge. I mean, neither of the Marys had much of a speaking part. You were great. Thanks. My mother made my costume. Two robes. The outer one was striped and the other one was solid maroon. She even made a turban out of the striped material. Hey, you were lucky to have a mother who would buy material and make a costume just for a Sunday school play. I remember that all the other kids had been draped in things like sheets, towels, bathrobes, and birdcage covers. I guess I was sort of lucky. So are you coming back to faith, I asked? Well, we're United Methodists now, my uncle's church. Oh, by the way, what is your name and your sign while you're at it? Oh, I'm sorry, Jean, but you can call me Stevie. That's right, I remember now. And I'm a Libra, I smiled. Hey, I'm a Gemini. Hey, you're not hooked up with anybody, are you? No, not really. I flashed on Roland for a minute, but I reminded myself that we were just friends. He never made a move or anything. Good then. Hey, let's say we go get a milkshake after school is over. Well, come on now. Don't deny me this time, Sean smiled. All right, I agreed. I've always been a sucker for dimples. And besides, my birthday wish might come true, I thought. Because that's it. Thanks. You know what? Next time we shouldn't get carbonated water. I almost get ready to belch. And I can belch in this scene. She gets to belch. But there were a couple times.
Hope I don't.
It was close.
Okay. Now is this is good now? Yes.
Okay, this is about a month. They couldn't hear you?
No, they couldn't hear
you. Oh, is it on?
It's on.
Okay, this is, I guess, a little bit later, a month later or so. Or it'll be revealed whenever it is, month or 2 months. You know how it is in high school, you go together 2 weeks, that's long. They practically married by now. You know, this is November, that was October. So. I had been rolling around in my underwear on the cot like a wild woman. Now I wrapped myself around the hot water bottle and held it like a baby. Thanks to it and my Midol tablets, cramps were no longer kicking my ass. Throwing up had made me feel better, too. I remembered that Tyrone had promised to make a stink bomb in chemistry lab this afternoon. I couldn't wait to see the look on Mr. Eversley's face. I sat up and blinked in the November sunshine that poured into the school nurse's sorry office. Nurse Horn was bent over her desk reading something, so I checked out the posters on the tired green walls. I studied the four food groups and yawned at the picture of the Red Cross nurse with a silly smile on her face. The posters got old quick. So I started thumbing through a fashion magazine. Nurse Horn wasn't skinny or glamorous like the ladies in the pictures, but she wasn't fat, and she was attractive in her own way. She wore hair short, not so short that she looked like she was about to go into the Marines, but probably too short for most men's tastes, I thought. I wondered if Nurse Horn would have found a husband by now if she wore her hair longer. She was pretty old not to be married. She looked every day of 25, as Mama would say.
How's the patient?
Nurse Horn turned around, smiling. She'll live, I guess.
You guess? You seem a whole lot better.
Yeah, I was seriously considering a sex change operation.
You'd have to go to California for that.
Nurse Horn walked toward me, and I noticed for the first time that she wore a white terry cloth bathrobe instead of her nurse's uniform. She felt my forehead like my mother did, first with the back of her hand and then with her palm.
Jean, you'll be fine.
How come you're in a bathrobe? What happened to your uniform? I asked, pointing to the white dress draped over the heater.
Oh, Crystal Jones vomited on me this morning.
I made a face. Yuck!
All in a day's work. I keep this robe handy for just such emergencies.
Crystal Jones threw up on you this morning. Morning sickness, I whispered excitedly. Nurse Horn raised her eyebrows like she knew she'd let the cat out of the bag.
I didn't say that.
She tried to pretend like I was totally off base.
And I shouldn't have mentioned Crystal's name to you at all.
Nurse Horn let out a sigh as she shook the thermometer down and walked toward her desk. You didn't have to. The word is already out. This just puts the icing on the cake. Some folks say it's Calvin's baby, but Carla says Dwayne was Crystal's main squeeze a few months ago. Nurse Horn turned around and faced me.
Shush. I don't want to hear another word about it. This is not some sort of game. You're talking about a person's life, and I won't listen to you make light of some poor girl's misfortune.
Nurse Horn's eyes narrowed, and I could tell she wasn't jiving. I started getting dressed, and Nurse Horn sat down at her desk and began writing out my pass.
I'm supposed to tell you that a young man came by while you were asleep.
Sean? That's my boyfriend. Isn't he cute? I pulled on my corduroy pants.
I believe he did say his name was Sean.
I stuck my head through my turtleneck. Actually, Sean is what you call fine. And he's a senior. Shoot, plenty of girls wish they could get next to Sean. Out of all the girls, I'm the one he asked to go with him. It was like a dream. I was Cinderella, and he was the prince. I put on my boots.
You're not in love by any chance.
Nurse Horn turned around at her desk. I guess you could run a train up my nose, I answered. I stood behind Nurse Horn waiting for her to give me my pass, but she just sat there staring out the window like she was in a daze. Did I say something wrong?
It's snowing. It's the first snow of the season.
Yeah, but I bet it won't stick. I hope it does, though. I watched the puffy white snowflakes drift slowly to the ground. How come you seem so sad? Will you have to shovel it?
Just reflecting.
Nurse Horn turned around and looked at me and then went back to staring out the window. In a few months, we'll all be sick of it. I tried to force a laugh. Nurse Horn turned and looked at me again, but a smile was nowhere near her face. She made no move to give me the pink slip of paper on her desk.
Jean, I guess I'm a little concerned about you now, frankly.
Concerned about me? Why? What are you concerned about me for? Hey, I'm not the one who's pregnant. I didn't know where Nurse Horn was coming from. Why was she tripping on me? I didn't want her putting me in the same boat with Crystal Jones. Nurse Horn looked me dead in the eye.
Not yet. At least you're not pregnant this month.
I felt myself getting all hot around the collar, and I jumped back and put my hands on my hips. You got no right to say that. Hey, I've known the facts since I was 12.
Do you know that if you play with fire, you're going to get burned? Do you know that fact?
Nurse Horn stood up and faced me with her arms folded. She looked silly standing there all stiff, staring me down. Who did she think she was? I was even about an inch taller than her. Who says I'm playing with anything? I raised my eyebrows and folded my arms, too. Nurse Horn cleared her throat.
I didn't say that you were.
Well, why are you all up in my business, then? I came down here to get well, not to catch hell. I wish it was time for chemistry, and I was learning how to make a stink bomb instead of dealing with this mess.
I'm sorry you see it that way.
How was I supposed to see it, I wondered. Why was this woman all over my case? Here I finally had a real boyfriend and I couldn't even enjoy it. Nurse Horn was acting like I was a baby or something. I turned 16 almost 2 months ago. I was the only 16-year-old virgin left on the whole south side of Chicago, according to Carla. Look, even if I was doing something, how could you help me? Could you get me the pill without my mother knowing?
The only pills I can give you are aspirins, you know that. But I can help you determine what you want out of life.
Maybe I don't want to determine what I want out of life. Maybe I just want to live. Nurse Horn shook her head.
I just know what can happen, and I'm concerned, that's all.
I don't need your concern. Just because I said I have a boyfriend, you started getting on my case. It hit me that Nurse Horn was probably jealous of me because she was an old maid. But that still didn't give her the right to jump on my case. Nurse Horn started pacing with her arms folded.
I just don't want you to end up another statistic.
A statistic? Oh, please. I threw my hands up in the air. First of all, my name is Jean Stevie Stevenson, not Crystal Jones. And second of all, you need to be concerned about the statistics of your finding a husband instead of worrying about me. I was surprised to hear that come out of my mouth. I bit my bottom lip and felt kind of sorry about what I'd said, but it was too late. Nurse Horn walked toward me with her face all scrunched up, pointing her finger at me.
Shut your mouth, young lady, because right now, I feel like slapping you.
Oh, I'd never seen Nurse Horn lose her cool, but I took a few steps backward just to be safe. Oh, yeah? You hit a student and you might get fired. Not to mention that I'd hit you back. I tried to sound tough.
Jean, you're skating on awfully thin ice.
Nurse Horn pointed her finger up at my face again. I was scared and mad at the same time. Nurse Horn had her nerve talking about smacking somebody. What did she think this was, Gone with the Wind? You don't have to point your finger up in my face. My mama ain't dead.
Okay, Jean, you had to push it. Get your things and get out of my office now. I want you out of my sight.
My mouth flew open. This lunatic in a bathrobe was actually calling herself, throwing me out of the nurse's office. I stuck my hand out for my pass. Nurse Horn knew I'd get stopped in the hallway without it. She started waving her arms in the air all dramatic-like.
Just go over there and sit down.
I wish the woman would make up her mind. Nurse Horn glanced up at the clock.
This period is halfway over anyway. I don't want you to leave with things like this.
She let out a big sigh.
I'm going to make us some peppermint tea. I got it from a health food store in Newtown.
I plopped down on the cot and watched Nurse Horn fill up the teapot and plug it in. I had never even tasted peppermint tea before. Nurse Horn was really a trip, I thought. One minute she was going off on me, and the next minute she was making me tea. It wasn't like we were in England or some damn where. I sat across from Nurse Horn, staring into my cup and breathing the peppermint steam. Nurse Horn leaned forward, holding her cup with both hands. She took a sip of her tea.
Jean, perhaps I was a little unfair to you, and I apologize. It's just that I see girls get into trouble year after year, and sometimes I get frustrated. In many ways, it was easier when I was in high school, back in the late 50s. At least there weren't as many pressures. We certainly weren't in the middle of a sexual revolution.
They barely had TV back in the 50s, I thought to myself. Nurse Horn continued.
Why, I remember my best friend and her boyfriend getting suspended from school for wearing look-alike sweaters. The administration didn't think it was appropriate.
I rolled my eyes in shock. I was glad it was 1969, but I didn't say anything. I just let Nurse Horn speak her piece.
It's part of my job to care about students, but I'm also a person. I don't just shut my feelings off every day at 3:30 p.m.
Nurse Horn sipped some more tea. I finally looked up at her. I realized that I'd never even thought of Nurse Horn going home. I guess I never pictured her outside of this office, at least not without her uniform on. But I had to admit that Nurse Horn probably was a person. I drank some tea.
I feel that there's something special about you. I know that you try to act tough, but I remember the first time you came down here. You were just a scared freshman.
I was surprised that Nurse Horn could remember the first time I'd ever come down here. I couldn't even remember that myself. And it was hard to picture myself as a scared freshman. A scared freshman? I'm a mighty junior now. Are you sure you don't have me mixed up with somebody else?
Positive. I know that you can be sensitive. Maybe that's why I was so hard on you. Because I think you have a lot of potential.
I could hardly believe Nurse Horn was saying all this stuff. I took a big drink of tea. How do you know I have a lot of potential? Excuse me. I belched. Excuse me. Or is that what you tell all the girls? Nurse Horn smiled and set her cup on the floor.
No, but it's what I'm telling Jean Stevie Stevenson.
The only time you see me practically is when I'm throwing up or rolling around in pain.
Well, I saw you in the school play, and you're almost as dramatic.
You saw me in the effect of gamma rays on Man in the Moon Marigolds? I was surprised that Nurse Horn kept up with things outside of her office.
Yes, I did, and I was quite affected.
I had to admit that I was good. Carla had said, "Girl, you played your heart out up there on that stage." "Thanks," I said to Nurse Horn, feeling shy all of a sudden. "No, we wanted to do No Place to Be Somebody or Nobody Knows My Name. You know, something really happening. But Mr. Turner was too evil to check them out." Nurse Horn looked embarrassed, like she didn't want to go along with bad-mouthing the drama teacher. I slurped my tea. "So, are you trying to tell me that you think I'm special out of all the jokers that come down here needing medical attention?"
"I wouldn't put it exactly in those terms."
"Well, when did you first notice that I had potential? When you saw me in the play or the first time that I threw up?" Nurse Horn picked a piece of lint off my arm.
"Sometimes you just have a feeling about someone. You can't always explain it logically."
"Like Carla liking Tyrone, kind of he's bow-legged and got curly hair?" Nurse Horn smiled and looked at me with her soft gray eyes.
"Well, not quite. I care about you. And I want you to have a good life."
I swished some tea around in my mouth thinking. Ain't nobody had ever told me they wanted me to have a good life before. A good day, yes, but not a good life. "If this was a TV show, this is when they play the music," I sighed.
"What music?"
"You know, the kind of music they used to play when they found Lassie." Nurse Horn pinched my cheek playfully. "If I hadn't just made 16, I would have wanted to bury my face all up against her terry cloth robe. She looked so warm and cozy." I set my cup down on the floor. "Nurse Horn?"
"Yes, Student Jean?"
"Okay, Miss Horn. Miss Horn, I'm sorry about the stuff I said about you needing to find a husband." Nurse Horn looked at me like everything was cool. "And I'm sorry about making light of some poor girl's misfortune, too." Nurse Horn leaned over and hugged me. I felt myself get all stiff. "Wait a minute," I wanted to say. "Hey, nobody hugs me except my grandmother. I'm 16 years old. My mother doesn't even hug me. And what if somebody walks in here and sees us all hugged up like we're in a Hollywood movie?" But it felt kind of good. The terry cloth was brushing up against my face and everything. So I just broke down and wrapped my arms around Nurse Horn and hugged her back. And then I began to inch away because I didn't know how long. It's too long, you know, to be hugging on somebody. "Nurse Horn, Miss Horn, about Sean, you see with Sean, I barely got my big toe in the water. I mean, I want to swim out there in that ocean of love. But in some ways, I want to stay safe on the shore." Nurse Horn rested her chin in her hand like she was taking in everything I was saying. Then the bell rang so loudly, I jumped. I started grabbing my stuff together. "Thanks for the tea and all," I handed her my empty cup. "It's been real, but I gotta get to chemistry. Tyrone's gonna show us how to make a stink bomb." Nurse Horn frowned.
"Well, promise me you'll talk to me if you need to."
"Okay, I promise."
"And watch your nutrition and exercise regularly. And you won't get such bad cramps."
"Okay, less junk food and more sex," I grinned. Nurse Horn pretended to hit me. I backed away laughing. "Just kidding. Now can I have my pass?"
"Here, and stay out of that ocean."
A warm feeling went through me as I stumbled into the mad rush of students in the hallway. I was glad that Nurse Horn wasn't married. I would hate to have to think of her going home to take care of some husband. Instead, I pictured her all curled up at home in a terry cloth bathrobe, sipping peppermint tea, and smiling to herself because she was thinking about me. Damn, I felt like running outside and tasting a snowflake instead of going to chemistry and making a stink bomb. Great audience. I thought that's one of your people. Good.
Is that
you take her bitch out. No, thanks. You all are wonderful artists. You're great. We got through it. How many rehearsals? We only had two.
Don't tell me.
Two, really? Two. That's not bad. Two. We didn't even stumble. You know, I was thinking, you know, because some of it I had to keep up with her. Like, she sighed. She this, and I was just waiting to miss one of those. It was good. I liked it. It was a great experience. I'm glad it's over. No.
Yeah.
No, not for the lyric. Cut. No, it's wonderful. Now we get to kick back, sort of, and you get to ask questions. You can ask Sheila, talk to her. I'm going to let her talk some because I'm always doing this. So, you know, just feel free to you know, respond, to say what you want to say, tell us your life story, whatever. It's on tape, on film. He's nervous when I say that.
A few minutes and he's still be on film.
So, yeah, we have, where is Paul? Did he stand up yet? How are we on time? We're fine. Okay, so that'd be good for questions and answers. Okay. I get that question. I don't. See, they didn't tell me about tea. That's out of my league. Does anyone know about tea? Let me get my water. Here's my cup. I reached for it one time. I was going to drink my tea. I don't know. Do we have an answer? Can someone think of a funny
that we can keep for next time? Yeah.
We'll work on that and get
water
back
will
to
make
you
clear. Did you hear that?
Water will make you clear. Someone's trying to say milk will make you clear. Yes.
Did you resist Sean's charms?
When?
Read the book.
No, yeah, that's right. Do your homework. Don't come back. No, she doesn't resist. Who's read the book? Some of you have read the book, maybe you'll respond. Your answer probably is as good as mine. What are you going to say something? Well, don't put you spoke up, sir.
I said, read the book.
Oh, that's all you're going to say? It's a tough audience. That's like they come in the Midwest. Usually they're kind of laid back here. No. She doesn't resist Sean's charms. She falls for Sean, but she gets in conflict because she's drawn to Nurse Horn in a whole different way, I feel. Nurse Horn is more of a role model, and it's a crush, more of a crush, like someone she admires, where Sean is her boyfriend. But she's kind of scared with Sean. She wants to have a boyfriend, and she's attracted to Sean, but she's kind of scared of her sexuality with Sean, whereas Nurse Horn in some ways is safer, but she's also kind of offering her more unconditional love rather than just what a teenager can offer her. You know, what can a 16-year-old boy really, you know? You know what I'm saying? Okay. It's that kind of thing. It's that kind of conflict. It's that kind of party. Okay. Hex. But read the book.
She gets my copy.
Yeah.
Is any of this autobiographical?
No. Of course. Some of it, but not most. Let's see. Did we read any of none of the part that I read? None of that part is autobiographical today, tonight. Because there was no Nurse Horn, unfortunately. you know, everybody needs a Nurse Horn. She's a fictional character. Sean, sort of, I had a boyfriend that could have been somewhat, you know, but I've made up this part. It was fictional, these scenes. They could have happened, but they didn't. Let's put it that way. But some of the book, there are a few things that happened. So, yes.
You actually did grow up on the South Side, and how did you end up leaving Chicago?
Leaving Chicago?
Yeah, did you actually
grow up on the South Side?
I did grow up on the South Side of Chicago.
How did you end up leaving?
I flew out. I did. I took a plane. But no, I went away to college too. That was my first step. And then I came out to San Francisco after I graduated for looking for a job. I got a job out here and I stayed. Yes. Downstate Illinois, Western Illinois University. This is state school. They wanted me to go to a more Ivy League school, you know, but I wanted to be cool. You know, it's like, I didn't want to go, the counselors, you know, because I was like in the National Honor Society and all that. That was true. But it was like, when I came out, people were looking to find themselves and all that. And it wasn't like you really wanted to bust your brain. And I didn't want to go somewhere up in Vermont or New Hampshire. You know, they had, you know how they, like, you're one of, I was like in the top in the school, but I grew up on the south side of Chicago, all black school. And I didn't want to go to some of those schools there. I just said, nah, I want to go where the friends are going and party, you know, so that's what I did. But in retrospect, I don't know, who knows? No, I went to Calumet. You know Chicago?
Yes.
You know Calumet? You wouldn't send your child there now. No, I said, you have to go through the metal detectors. My niece goes there, though, now.
Did you take writing in college?
Yes, journalism.
Journalism.
I don't think I took creative writing. Journalism. I was on the school newspaper. See, this woman and I just have a conversation. The rest of these people just forget about them. Yes, what else would you like to know? What else? I played softball. No, no, I didn't. No, I didn't. Took Spanish, no, but you know it takes a lot. No, go on. Okay, next. No, this is she's breaking notes. Well, this is on the library. I forgot we're in the library. Yes, yeah, now they're afraid. They're afraid of me. Talk to Sheila. Sheila, she won't. She's not as intimidating.
I'm not as intimidating.
She's sweet. No, Nurse Horn. Look at it. Yeah, talk to Nurse Horn. They're afraid.
They're afraid. They're even afraid of me.
They're on. They're. I know they're being filmed too.
Okay, I'll do another one.
Okay,
she said it. They like.
Where have you had the most fun going around the country? And I'm talking about your tour.
I thought you were gonna say. I thought you were gonna say. I'm talking about in the bookstores, you know, or something. And I was the most fun. It's hard to say. There were different experiences, different places. In Texas was unique. I'd say Chicago in a way, because that was my home when they came out in force, and especially the Black Women's Expo. I went to Chicago 2 months in a row. I did 2 bookstore readings there and a lot of, you know, media stuff. But then I went back in March. I was there in February. I went back in March and I did the Black Women's Expo. And it was like hundreds of women. It was, you know, but in the room, it was an auditorium for the Black women speak, and there were several of us. And so they treated me like a home, you know, coming home. They were like, yeah, yeah, you know, they were crazy. And it was fun and they were just right there. And there were people from the high school, like I said, where they were like, it was really, you know, that I would say probably because it was a home. But I had fun, and well, it was hard to say fun because it was grueling. Because I was like in some cities one day, I was in New York a day, and then D.C., and I left that morning, went there, and that night, leave it. And I've gotten to some places at 2-something in the morning and all that stuff, and then had to do a radio show at 6 or 7. So my schedule was grueling, but places that stand out in a way. Philadelphia, they came out in droves. I was surprised. I mean, that's, I mean, you know, it was nice. It was like I was famous there. You know, like some places you go, there are 30 people, and then there are 100. There was like there was over 100. You never know where how a place is going to be. And so Philadelphia, they really came out, and that was good. Houston and Dallas were interesting because, well, Houston was interesting because they had food. Only ones. And they had rock shrimp or something. You know, those Gulf shrimp. They were like, I came, I said, oh, you have food. You know, it was like, you know, you go different places. And she said, oh, of course we have food. You know, you never know, different parts of the country are different. Like, they wouldn't come without food, no. No, no. They just believe in the hospitality. They have their punch and the food and what have you. Come in and eat. And it was Valentine's Day. I think that might have something. I had a lot of couples. What? Have some food? No. Nowhere else did they. And so, and then in Dallas, they really... In Texas, I'd say they really put out, what did they say, put on the dog or put out the dog? Did they put the dog out the house? Or, you know, like some people say out the dog, put them out, and that was, you know, they put on the dog. Because in Dallas, too, they came, it was like a community thing. Really, it was touching. They came, they had cameras, a lot of people. I mean, child got a whipping in my audience in Dallas. You know, it was like everybody came. And it was like, no, I did. I had to speak out. Now, if you hit this child one more, bam! You know, they like in the South, you know, like you go to church. Bam, bam, preacher. Bam, I was in the, but I said, damn, the girl, she wore out. I mean, why would you bring a 3-year-old? So anyway, but I took a picture with the girl. I tried to, you know, help her self-esteem. And I said, she's going to grow up and be a writer. And I had her held up. She's crying. And then they gave her a little free. I made them, you know, I asked them to give her something and that kind of stuff. But nobody flinched but me. You know you're from the South. They don't, you're sitting up there. I'm like reading, almost ready to cry. And so that was kind of one. But they really in Dallas were very warm. But the thing is, they started very late. They're slow in Texas. You're from Texas. No, it's true. I believe we started about 45 minutes late, maybe an hour. And it was like they're calling. I hate to say, I'm not going to say their country. I'm going to try not to say that because it's on tape. But they were beautiful, warm, wonderful people. But it was just like they say, so-and-so's on her way. You know, it's like, hold up, don't start before cousin somebody gets there. And it was like, you know, it was supposed to start at 7:30. And it's like, you know, it's already 8 o'clock, and they said, "Well, don't start." So she just called. You know, they just finished eating. They're just doing the dishes. They'll be on their way. They're coming. And this is how it went on. I mean, I swear we started 45. And Houston was late too, but it was like the people came on in any old kind of time, and I was like on the last page. I swear, I'd read for a half hour. And I came, and they were still coming in, sauntering in. And they didn't even rush about it. And they were just coming on in anytime. They're like, oh. And then they came when I was signing. You know, they were still coming in. And they said, oh, did you read already? I said, well, yeah, it's 9 o'clock. Yes, you know, that kind of thing. But it didn't bother them. They bought the book anyway. That was another thing. Somebody said they probably were having affairs. And they said, well, this is approved. I was there. I got the book she read forever, you know. They came at 9 o'clock. Everyone bought the book in Houston. Everyone in Dallas, almost. They all bought the book. It didn't matter whether they had heard a line or anything. It was like, oh, you finished already? Okay. I have 6. You know, sign these 6. And it was like, you know, how do you know you won it? It was like the event of the, you know, you do it. So they were different. Milwaukee, and they came in out of Milwaukee in a blizzard and droves. They kind of considered themselves part of Chicago, I guess. So they saw it as a home. And that was like, I was in February and March, most of February, so you can imagine. And they were tough, that Midwest, you know, like they try to tell you what to do, too. Unlike California, it was like, well, what's going to happen to Stevie? You know, people just get all of, you know, well, I want Stevie to this. I want Stevie to that. Well, I want this. But it was so cute in Houston when this one woman said, I don't believe, was the last question. Those are always the, you know, you never know. You can make it through. You think you've made it through? Okay. This is one of them said, I don't believe that Stevie was really that way. It was so cute. And it was like, nothing had come up like that. It was just Houston. I just think she just liked the woman, you know, because Nurse Horn, she was white, but she was nice. And it was like that. She said, but you know what I mean? She was nice. And I don't think she was that way. I think that people were trying to put that on Stevie, but I don't really think she was like that. And that was all. She never said anything but that way and like that. This was Texas. It was like, so it was, and then when I first hit Texas, boy, I should talk about Texas. So I first hit Texas, there was like this radio comment, what are you undermining family values? No, this, I said, no, this book is tame. The library is nominated, I didn't know that now. It's nominated for Book of the Year for Young Adults. I mean, what's not to like about that? You know, how can I be undermining family values? But anyway, so it was interesting going some part, different parts of the country because the attitudes are different, somewhat. Not totally, but it's just more conservative, I'd say a little more. In the Midwest, some too. But then you get hip, cool people everywhere too, because I did another Texas radio show where they were, you know, really cool. In fact, they were talking about reparations. You never know who you're going to get. You do this radio show, I might do one conservative show, and then the next minute they whisk me off to someone talking about one person saying, why do you think black people are going down the drain, you know, or something. Then the next person I go to, what about reparations and, you know, oppressed people, blah, blah, blah. What do you think, sister? And it's just a woman hadn't read my book. But, you know, you want the commentator to like you. This was in Dallas, and she's like, so this sister is really kicking, check it out in your book, you know, on the radio. And I'm like, you know, I'm not gonna antagonize her. So, but she goes, but I'm also with this publishing company, major publisher. And they do check you out, what you say, you know, you don't, it gets back to them sometimes. So she said, what do you think about reparations for African people or whatever? You know, and I'm on the radio and I'm thinking, well, how do I get out this? And I gotta, you know, I said, well, we need something, you know. I don't know about reparations. So she said, right on, sister. I said, the girl's sister's kicking, check it out. Coffee will make you play. And I was like, all right, right on. And you know, and I was like, phew, on to the next. Because I can't get back to, you know, Hyperion. You know, Hyperion is owned by Walt Disney. I hope there's not. No. They're wonderful too, though. So anyway, how are we? Paul, stand up. We have 5 minutes. This woman, yeah. Will you? I'm going to get him in the back. I'm writing a sequel to Coffee Will Make You Black. I can't tell you the title, but no, you'll never guess. And this is a two-book deal. When we sold the book, I'm going to see if some of the little stories that get out are not all true. Let me make sure. I'm going to tell you what happened in a real short version. I had, most of it was true, Paul. You were pretty close, but you can't believe everything you read. I can tell you that. But let's see. I did do 20 pages that were the middle of the book when I read my first reading. 125, not 100. And, no, but that was close. We had half a book when I sold it. I found an agent. You're right. The agents, a few of them came to me because of the readings. And we sold half a book and a synopsis, sent it out to 8 publishers. Hyperion jumped the gun. We gave them like 2 weeks or something. Excuse me, that carbonated water, I'm telling you. And so they wanted it in 3 days. Most of them hadn't read it yet. It wasn't like I was known. I was an unknown. But Hyperion read it first, I suppose. There were a couple Crown had called. They were interested. Avon wanted it, so they did the paperback rights. We just sold them the paperback rights. We had like a 2-day auction, so it was good. They were bidding war, so we sold it to them. It was good. I'm out of the red, basically, because of that. So with my advances. So it was like we sold the first half, and they said, they gave me a take-it-or-leave-it offer that day. Now, see, I didn't know. You know, they probably would have stuck around. But at the time, you know, I wasn't going to pass it up because I didn't have anything. So, and Mama hadn't raised no fool. So they just said, you have a 2-book deal. And I took it. Take it or leave it. Boom, boom, boom. So that's why I'm doing, that's one reason I'm doing the sequel. I have no choice. Other reasons, I probably want to do a second book anyway at some point. But this way, I was really locked into the contract to do a sequel with them. So it will be coming out. I'm supposed to finish at the end of this year. One final question, that's, you know, with this,
for a screenplay.
We hope so. Disney asked for the exclusive for the film rights. They let it run out, but they haven't passed. And there are a few other people. I think Jodie Foster has it. They asked for it. Harpo, Oprah has it. She, they called for it. Not that they couldn't. We had to mail them the book, too. Could have bought it at the bookstore, my mother said. You mean to say Oprah couldn't go buy that book as much money as she has? You had to, see, I had to pay for these books. I get a 40%, what do I get, 40%, you know, 40%, I had to pay 40% or whatever, or off, or one of them, you know, whatever the discount. You mean to say Oprah had, my mother, you mean to say Oprah had to call out to California, to San Diego, to my agent, to have you, Federal Express, a book to her, and you have to pay for those books, and you haven't seen a royalty check, you know, it's like, as much money as Oprah has, just like you'd be just so excited to say Oprah wanted your book, she could have sent someone down to buy it. But, you know, of course, now I know she has it. So I don't mind, you know, what's a few dollars. So maybe she'll do something with it. Who knows? Anyway, is that it? Oh, we're wrapping up. Okay, like we're finishing our filming, and oh, it's supposed to be till 8:30. I'll take a few questions after you shut down. So yeah. Are you shutting down?
Yeah.
Thank you, audience. Oh, this is Sheila talk. You don't want to?
Okay, ask me something.
Look, even if I was doing something, how could you help me? Could you get me the pill without my mother knowing?
The only pills I can give you are aspirins, you know that. But I can help you determine what you want out of life.
Maybe I don't want to determine what I want out of life. Maybe I just want to live. Nurse Horn shook her head.
I just know what can happen.